morning. So good time of the day. So thank you all very much for coming. So today we are happy to have Arkady Berenstein from the University of Oregon. And the title of the talk will be Geometric Multiplicities. Please.
Thank you very much for the invitation, opportunity to speak at such a famous seminar. So my talk is based on the joint paper with Yanpeng Li from University of Geneva or somewhere else at the moment, probably Toronto, but since it's a bit uncertain, then he's somewhere in between at the moment. The idea is to try to put a framework into at least some cases of the famous multiplicity problem and to geometrize it to as much extent as possible. So the problem is very classical. It's probably started with a notion of representation. It just says that if you have two reductive groups, probably a complex connected, one is subgroup of another, then we can compute, or at least define the multiplicity of a G-module, reducible G-module with the label the highest weight mu, in the restriction from G prime to G of the reducible G prime module V prime lambda prime is just, it refers to the group G prime. So of course the category is semi-simple. You restrict, you get a number of summons, so you pack them into additive components, and multiplicity is just how many simple modules may occur in that additive component, which I denote by M lambda mu. Well, it's very famous and old problem, I would say. It refers not only to reductive groups, but to any pair of groups. But for reductive groups, complex ones, of course, it's especially pretty because, well, there is a hope to solve it at least in some cases. So there are two particular cases which are known from time, for a long time. One is the so-called weight multiplicity, when the group G is just the Cartan subgroup of G prime, the maximal torus. And in this case, the module V prime, the lambda prime, F R with lambda, decomposes into weight weight components, the lambda of mu, and the multiplicity in question is the dimension of the lambda of mu. The second famous case is when the big group is the product of two copies of small group and the bell is diagonal. Then the multiplicity, if you take the G times G module, it has a label lambda nu, and you restrict it to G, and it's exactly, well, a reducible module for the product is the product of reducible modules. And what we get is a tensor product multiplicity, which is also a famous constant in representation theory. In the case when the group was general linear, the answer was known for a long time. Combinatorially, the first question was answered by the number of semi-standard Young tableaus of the shape lambda and content and fade mu, if you like, number of occurrences of each symbol. Similarly, for the tensor product problem, it was also product of sure functions, which are the characters of those modules. It's known as a little just a number, and it's number of semi-standard tableaus of some shape and with some conditions. However, this doesn't go too far. If you replace group GLN by other groups, this doesn't always work. In some cases, the Young tableaus show up. In other cases, it's hard even to build a product for G2 or F4. There is a approach which is kind of uniform due to first constant and then Heckman, who generalized constant's idea to the fullest generator. For that, we need to look at either the character formula, Weyl character formula, or which is the same thing as DGG resolution, to get the multiplicity in question, and it goes like this. First of all, Heckman claimed that the multiplicity is algebraic sum of quotient partition functions. Let me just right? Well, true of everything. So epsilon is just the character of the while group, W prime. Prime means it's the group G prime, which takes values negative one on reflections. It's just the sign of permutation if the group G prime was generally near one. Pi is the projection of the weight lattices induced by the inclusion of the tori. By the way, when we look at inclusion of the groups G into G prime, we can always pick up the maximum tori which match, as well as with everybody else, whatever you want. So anyway, on the tori, it's just the projection, which in particular takes positive root system on the big group onto the positive root system of small group, but with non-trivial fibers. And P is the generalized Poisson partition function defined by a generating series, where the product is taken over the multi-set. So we look at how many times we hit the root system, a particular root of G, and then take the multiplicity minus one because we remove the single copy of R plus. So anyway, it's just all well defined. You can see it in the Heckman and follow-up papers. And this is the formula which, well, probably computes everything and looks like it closes the field. But the issue is that this formula is alternating, and therefore we don't get satisfactory combinatorial answer as in the other, well, as for GLN, for instance. And the question is, well, what to do with those signs? Well, one approach which we employed a long time ago with Andrei Zelevinsky, actually Andrei suggested it to me in mid-80s, is to cancel the negative terms in the sum with some of the positive terms and keep only the term corresponding to W equals one, so that the Poisson partition function is here, takes the biggest value. And if you, well, kill the negative terms, then we kill part of this initial term, but still much of it survives. Well, that worked, but only in the cases which we already know the answer for the series. Mm-hmm. And well, now probably for some other reductions like G2 and A2, and maybe F4 and B4 and a few other cases. But again, it's, well, it gives a hope to obtain the answer, but it doesn't tell what the answer should look like. So maybe I'll refer to the result which we produced with Andrei Zelevinsky in 2001 after, well, almost 15 years of work. So for that, we need a notion, which again, probably is not the best, but I just give a name to a pair G and G prime tropical. If there exists a convex plicital cone inside a lattice or inside R to the N, it doesn't matter. N is just some constant dependent on G and G prime. And the homomorphism of abelian groups from that ambient lattice to the lattice of weights of G prime times G, such that if you take the fiber over any point lambda mu, so lambda comes from P prime, mu comes from P, that the fiber in the cone over point lambda mu is typically a polytope in the lattice. Well, we can take real ones, it's an honest polytope. Hopefully it's compact because then we can count number of points, otherwise it's infinity. The multiplicity is going to be the tropical one. So the actual multiplicity is going to be the tropical one, but of course, that's a dream. So we really want to classify all such tropical pairs, but we know at the moment a number of them. So the theorem which we proved with Andrei is that if you take such pairs as, well, a standard tensor one, or a Levy inside a reductive group, then these pairs are tropical actually in many, many, many ways. I would say in infinitely many ways, but the formulas which produced were, well, the number of cones were, roughly speaking, the number of reduced words of the longest element of the while group of G, or something smaller for the pair LG. In other words, so we found around the bound, and instead of canceling the terms in the Heckman formula, we tried to, well, to directly find this cone, directly or by some other methods. Maybe I'll show some example which everyone knows by heart. So the first one is when we take big group to be GL3 and the small group is just the maximal torus of it. Then multiplicity, the cone in question, this cone which we want to produce, is the cone of delta certain patterns. Indeed, the inequalities are linear, so it's closed under addition and it's only a peripheral cone. So also we need the projection. Probably I changed notation and forgot to do it in the next slide. It should be 8, not pi. Or pi probably should be here, pi, but not 8, but doesn't matter. Anyway, it's projection from that cone to the pairs lambda mu, which is given by the standard formula. We take the top row of the Gilfatzian pattern, is the dominant weight, clearly it's dominant because of the inequalities. And the second component mu is going to be the weight, is the bottom component, the sum of the middle ones minus the bottom one, and the sum of the top ones minus the sum of the middle ones. In particular, the sum of lambdas equals the sum of mu's, which is making the multiplicity non-zero. Well, that's indeed the multiplicity is tractable. And the second example is explaining the first one. If you take the pair, the Levy inside, the maximal possible Levy inside GLN, which is GLN minus one times C star, and then this cone is very small, it's just the two rows with all those inequalities. And actually I have hidden the last component of mu, which is given by the equation that sum of lambda is equal to sum of mu's. And the projection pi, which is whatever weight, is clear. You just take the top row, you take the bottom row and add the missing component. Sum of lambda is equal to sum of mu's. And actually this multiplicity is one or zero because the projection is injective. Projection pi is injective. So you, if you are in the correct locus, you get one. If you are not in correct locus, you get a zero. So the multiplicity in question is just a characteristic function of that cone. Well, that's good to know, but of course, if you build up, if you look at the chain of the Levis, for instance, next one is GL minus two times C star squared, right? You can add more rows, etc. And this gives a non-trivial multiplicity of restriction from GLN to its maximum torus. So the multiplicity is thus tractable. So the group, the pair G and T are is tractable. Well, now I'd like to kind of make a dictionary between this and some point of algebraic geometry from the example one. So of course, to define a cone, we can use the inequalities in the standardized form. So all inequalities which were listed, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, can be written as, minimum of differences is non-negative. Of course, it's not unique. You can multiply any of these linear forms by a constant, but it's clear that it's unnecessary here. Then one can replace this minimum by Laurent polynomial in the variables with the same names at least, which goes like this. If you see a difference, you replace it by a ratio. If you see a minimum of something, you replace it by a sum of those things. Well, minimum and sum or differences, minimum plays role of summation, of addition, and sum plays role of the product in this tropical calculus. But if you really want to go back to the something real, we can detropicalize it this way. So therefore, if you remember this Laurent polynomial, we can easily recover the cone by the procedure of tropicalization. Okay. Going back, replacing the ratios by differences, sums by minima, and products by sums. For instance, here, if you look at the weight from the previous slide, which was called pi for some reason, then this becomes a product over a singleton, become product of three over product of two after we did tropicalize, which it is. Well, there is a cute remark which just gives a glimpse into mirror story, is that if you fix highest weight, it's just the parameters, fixed in the same sense that they're not variables, they are constants at the moment, and take the critical locus, which means you the zeros of derivatives of this phi get fixed lambdas, then it's the same thing as the spectrum of the quantum cohomology algebra of the flag variety in this space. And it's not a coincidence, it's true for, in this notation, it's true for GLN and torus. And once we write this potential read off from the Bill-Fancerin patterns, that's the same answer. So of course, we should be slightly more careful if we want the actual quantum cohomology algebra, we need to some regularity. So the Jacobi algebra of this potential is, up to some small localizations equals the quantum cohomology of the corresponding flag variety. That explains why interpolation is beneficial, because sometimes we can hit a superpotential for some Landau Ginzburg model. And actually, we'll try at some point to do it more uniform. Then, just to fix how we tropicalize things, because we'll do it a lot, I briefly recall the results from our work with David Cartan, starting from 2000. If you have two split algebraic tori, say over rationals, now I'm going to use language algebraic geometry, but if it's uncomfortable, just you can say that multiplicative group is C star, torus is just C star to the power. We can look at rational morphism between two tori, morphism from one torus to another. We say it's positive. Since I don't want to use coordinates, I'll try to do it in the coordinate free manner. If for any character, the composition of the function with this character, which is just a function on the first torus, is a positive rational function. Positive rational function means it's a ratio of two Laurent polynomials, or polynomials, depending on where you are, with non-negative integer coefficients. That's fair enough. It's practically, it means that if each torus is just a power of the multiplicative group, then each coordinate of the image is a positive rational function of the map. So we denote by T plus the category of such positive tori. So the objects are split algebraic tori over Q, and arrows are positive rational morphisms. Then we can tropicalize things. Again, I'll try to do it in free manner, but we'll see how it works in that example. So for every to any positive function, we assign a function, I should call it f, as always when I change notation, something quite happens. So anyway, it should be f to the t. It's an entropical function f, which goes from the lattice of co-characters of the torus. If the torus was a power of multiplicative group, of course, the lattice is also a power of Z, but I really want to keep the structure by several conditions. First of all, if the function was a character itself, character of the torus S, then clearly it induces a map from co-characters to Z because it's a duality pairing. And then we can build it up by taking sums. Sums go to minima, as we already seen. Products go to sums. And the quotients, of course, go to differences. And then we can extend it to any positive morphism from a torus S to torus S prime by saying that if we compose it with a character, of course, I meant of S prime, sorry for typos, then this function, this tropicalization of the morphism composed with the character is going to be just the function which we defined line before. Well, practically, again, it means that every time you see a variable, you still call it a variable. Variable belongs to Z and so forth. And then replace sum by minimum, product by sum, and quotient by difference. Well, what I proved with David Cartan a long time ago, I'm not sure if it's too deep, but it's something quite expected, that if you assign to every torus its lattice of co-characters, which will be denoted in for future by tropical torus, and to every positive morphism its tropicalization, it's a functor. So in particular, well, just most importantly, the composition of positive morphisms results in the composition of corresponding tropical maps. Well, that's a nice tool. At least we can use it for free, because usually if you compose to rational transformations which are not dominant, then it may fail to exist. So therefore, even the question about the category is open if you drop positivity. So either we have to look at the dominant rational morphism, that's the only hope in general, or we need to put some positivity to prevent from the undefinedness of the composition. And since everything is defined, it's clear that, well, the tropicalization should be a functor, what else? Well, maybe I'll say a couple of words about positive varieties, which is essentially the same thing, but it has, it is a torus in many ways. So if I have a variety, well, typically reducible variety over Q, then we can define a positive structure on it to be the family of open embeddings from a torus to that variety. Of course, torus is split algebraic up to, well, we can change the torus by replacing it by its, replacing this embedding by the composition with the variation of the morphism of the torus. Which is positive, of course, otherwise positivity is lost. And what's more important, whose invert is also positive. This is not trivial, but actually there are many examples, because all cluster varieties X are positive in the sense that every cluster chart is a, S is the torus formed by the cluster chart, and Laurent phenomenon guarantees that it openly embeds into the variety as long as it's a variety. Sometimes it's not. And then if we change from one cluster to another, it results in biracial automorphism of this torus. And still it's an open embedding due to the same Laurent phenomenon, which means that it's not an empty notion. There are quite a few examples in nature. For instance, every reductive group, every flag variety, maybe a basic affine space, GMU, et cetera. So lots of varieties are cluster ones. And of course, in particular, as a free bonus, they are positive. So simply we'll refer to such a variety as a positive one. And of course we want to get as many such embeddings as possible connected by positive variational morphisms whose derivative is positive. However, there is a warning that it's not for free. If we want the inverse of a variational morphism to be positive, it's not a trivial task. Actually, for me, it's a kind of, if it works, it could be kind of new Cremona theory. Study variational morphisms of the torus, which are positive and whose inverse are positive. And let me show, as always, I make a mistake being the crash. It's not a theorem, it's a counterexample. So the counterexample says that the positivity of the morphism doesn't imply the positivity of its inverse. For instance, if you take the most naive one, which you probably always mixed up, which takes a pair xy to x plus y, then its inverse is not positive. And its tropical version, which probably, again, I have to switch the variables, it should be x in the first place because we tropicalize x to itself, and x plus y tropicalizes to the minimum of xy. So sorry for that mistake. But anyway, whatever is written, the component minimum of xy is less or equal than x, and therefore tropically is not invertible. Precisely because the inverse of original morphism was not positive. Therefore, the functoriality from the theorem fails to work because we wanted both f and f inverse to be positive to guarantee that they are tropically inverse of each other. Here, inverse of f tropically doesn't exist. So therefore, we have to be slightly more careful when we study, when we define positive varieties. If you find one chart, it's good. If you find many charts, it's a miracle. Okay, so now at least everything is ready to define the main object of my talk, which probably is a bit cumbersome. Well, maybe it doesn't make much sense at the first glance. But let me again go back before looking at this abstract notion and see what ingredients we want to preserve. So clearly, we want to preserve the variety. In this case, variety is just six-dimensional torus. We want to preserve the potential on it, which indeed will play some role of superpotential if you're lucky enough. And we want to preserve the highest weight of whatever data we have, and the weight. So that's the motivation of the definition in that next slide. So geometric multiplicity over a split algebraic torus, it doesn't have to be a torus of a group G, but it will become eventually, is a quadruple variety, the potential, highest weight map, and the weight map. So everything must be positive. So M is a positive variety, so it has a supply of positive charts. Phi is a positive regular function, which means it's a map from M to the multiplicative group, if you like, which is, well, if you replace M by its the torus S, then it will be a positive map from S to the multiplicative group. So it's not a clear notion. All the, so far, all these examples will provide a positive potential phi. Also the highest weight and weights are morphisms, well, rational in general, of course, positive from the variety M to T. So far in the previous examples, M was a torus itself of some big dimension, and both highest weight and weight were homomorphisms of terrain. It doesn't have to be so, but at least it's the best possible case. A homomorphism of terrain is always positive. The first one, highest weight is to the torus T, which we defined, and S is some auxiliary torus, which we didn't specify at the moment. Well, what I should say that it's, so S is varying, T is fixed. We'll see later why we need S to be varying, because it will inflate at some point as we produce some new multiplicities. It's clear that general multiplicities form a category where objects are multiplicities and the arrows are structure preserving maps. So the only thing we need to worry is the morphism from M to M prime and from S to S prime, which well naturally can get with the data, right? So it's a very initial category, and positivity guarantees that compositions are well defined. Well, that's just the very basic object. So it looks almost trivial. So of course, why not? But at least we can produce an actual multiplicity, a tropical one, by applying tropicalization to every single piece of the data. And the beauty of it is that it doesn't really depend on the choice of the toric chart. So each choice of toric chart up to a positive isomorphism between them, in both positive and both directions, induces an isomorphism of tropical varieties or tropical sets, if you like, and then multiplicities, if they are finite, are the same. So maybe, maybe I'll postpone it, but let me tell the main reason why we introduced this category. It turns out that there is a multiplication structure on this category of geometric multiplicities, which is defined, unfortunately, in a very, very complex way, and even half of the notation I skipped, because otherwise it will take probably five slides. Let me just start and get a taste of what multiplication is. So we define the product of this variety depending on the presence of an reductive algebraic group, split of course, with the maximal torus T. So again, before in the first slides it was complex group, now it's algebraic. Not big difference, but I just don't want to look at the points of the group, just algebraic structure. So first of all, the product is not the ordinary direct product. It's a product, well, again, I forgot on prime, sorry. Probably I'll update the slides and send the version after the talk. This is the product over a fiber over the square of the torus with some auxiliary variety, which is, once again, sorry for the typo, u times t times t. Where the fiber product is with respect to Well, for some reasons, it's more convenient to use this extra data t rather than saying that kill that copies of t and keep multiplying by u. U is the maximum unipoint subgroup of G normalized by t. Totally, they form a Borel subgroup. And now we have to upgrade all the data to the product. The first one, even with types, I hope it's clear. It's as a variety, it's m times m prime times u, because we kill this extra copies of t. But again, for some reasons, it's more convenient to write it as a fiber product. Then we need to define the highest weight map and the weight map. Highest weight is just a composition of the product of three maps, highest weight of one, highest weight of the second, and the identity on the on this last factor. And then we project down to the two copies of t from the last factor, which that's the only reason why we needed it. Okay. So totally it becomes a map from this bigger variety to the product of s, s prime, t and t. Actually, that explains why we need this highest weight to be varying. Because in the product, we get a bigger torus in the, for the highest weight as a target. So anyway, it inflates as we multiply, inflates by the copies of t. Then something which I try to, well, to sweep under the rug, the potential, which is of course the most important one, but unfortunately I don't have capacity to define this function. It's a well-defined positive function on u times t times t on u2, but it's very complicated definition, so I skip it. It's well-defined, it's written edited somewhere in our paper, but please trust me that it's a positive function, which makes sense. Well, the then the, well, again, I probably skip most of it under the rug. Double not bar is the representative in the group G of longest element in the VAT group, which I also will put in some format and then apply some undefined map. Well, called HW of G. So anyway, please please forgive me for being clumsy, because otherwise it takes forever. And of course, the bigger torus, which already observed, it's is that is double prime inflated by TNT. Well, hopefully, again, if we don't butter too much with annotation, which is a bit clumsy. So the bottom line is that multiplication is associative. And even though we lack a unit, clearly we lack it, because whatever was the unit, it is, well, the product of the units is something horrible. So therefore there is no unit in this category, but for every reductive group G which contains T as a maximal torus, this multiplicity variety is a, well, has associative multiplication. Well, again, the reason why it's so complicated is that I tried not to, or at least we tried not to tell the truth, namely that in fact behind all this is the category of so-called unipoint crystals, which we introduced to David Cartan in the second paper in 2007. But even defining them here will take also probably three or four slides. And I decided to, well, to choose the lesser of the evils. So anyway, one way or another, there is a monoidal functor from this category multi star G to the category of unipotent bicrystals, which basically multiplies every multiplicity by the group G over the torus T in whatever fashion. So there is a neat way to see it, but again, it requires a bit too much of notation. So then the only reason, or the primary reason why we needed this multiplication is there some kind of functor, which I don't know how to call, mirror functor, duality functor. It's a totally trivial thing if you look at it thoroughly, but let me just try to define it in these terms. So first of all, that's what I tried to say before, I introduced the product, that any multiplicity variety due to associativity can be tropicalized. So clearly, if you replace it by one of the tri S, involved in the positivity, then multiplication is well defined, and that's essentially what happens disregarding what orders we choose. So what we do, we take the variety, which is just lattice of characters of hidden torus. We cut out by the potential. So since everything was biregular, we took some precautions in the definition of positive chart. Our embedding of a torus, it's not called S anymore. It's some hidden torus behind the variety M. It was regular. So if you look at composition of the embedding and regular function, which is the potential on M, we obtain a Laurent polynomial with positive coefficients, and we can easily tropicalize it. Right? It becomes a piecewise linear function, actually minimum of linear for us, because the tropicalization of a Laurent polynomial is a minimum of linear functions. So therefore, if you look at the locus of non-negativity of this tropical potential, it becomes a convex polyhedral cone, as we already seen in the example of that unsettling one. So then we obtain now MT is just the one which not a lattice itself, but a cone cut out by the positivity locus, non-negativity locus of the tropicalized potential. So then we can look at the projection. Again, I had to change notation consistently. It's called, should be called weight. It's simultaneous projection. And again, I should call this guy P prime check, P check. Again, so check means that since we take lattice of characters of the torus, it's just the covariate lattice for the group G. Actually, that's the only reason for the less duality so far. Maybe there is a deeper one, but the only thing we observe is that the target lattice over which we fiber our cone MT is going to be the dual of the one we expect. Well, X star of S is just notation for the lattice of the character, so I probably should call it ST. But anyway, after correcting all the typos, hopefully it's clear that the tropical multiplicity is well defined. It's just the fiber over inside the cone of this lambda and whatever undisclosed point xi of the auxiliary torus S, with the hope that this number is number of such points in that tropical fiber is finite. But even if not, we can define its linearization. It's just a set. Linearization is a complex vector space. Tensor it with the irreducible module, the lambda check. Lambda check is the first component of the projection. And this defines typically infinite dimensional module over Langlands dual group the check, because we have no choice. If we use covariates for dominant covariates or just covariates for the group G, they are weights for the dual group G check. And therefore, we are forced to admit that the result is a representation of the Langlands dual group. And we add up such representations multiplied by the multiplicities over every single dominant weight available. Of course, some of them are empty, so we don't get the summons. But those which are non-empty give us typically infinite dimensional semi-simple representation of G-check. Well, and the nicest feature of this assignment, so to every multiplicity variety via this tropicalization process, we assign a module over G-check. The nicest feature is that indeed this is a functor, which is clear because clearly tropicalization is functorial, as we already seen before. But what's more important, this functor is monoidal. In the sense that even though there is no unit, well, and the unit never shows up on the right-hand side, right, trivial representation, still the products go to products. Well, at least it's some, again, I don't know how to treat it, but at least it shows that there is some geometry on the G side, which we assign some algebraic data on the G-check side. And this data is not far from geometry, because typically such infinite dimensional modules are covariant algebras of some G-check varieties. Maybe I'll show this example in the next slide. So if you take, bold face T means that the most trivial, maybe I'll go back to the original definition and comment on it. So what is the most natural object of this category? Of course, when M equals T, right? When potential is zero, highest weight is just dating its identity, and a weight is contracting to a trivial torus, which is just a single point. Right, so this will be called bold-faced H, or bold-faced T, whatever is more relevant. Bold-faced T, of course. So then we can, it's an object of our multiplicity category, and we can multiply it by itself as many times as we wish. What we get is not so far from obvious. You see, if you do it once, what happens? If you substitute T for M, then multiplicities are equal to one, and we get direct sum of all the Langlands checks, which is the model of representations of G-check. It's the same thing as coordinate algebra of G-check mod U-check. U-check is the unipotent, maximum unipotent subgroup of G-check. Then if you take if you use this theorem, we take the product, then clearly we multiply each single one, each single of the lambdas by many times and get a direct sum of the product, which is the same thing as coordinate algebra, or as the power, tensor power of the coordinate algebra of G check mod U check. And that's helps us to compute the tensor multiplicity, because you know that each multiplicity in question now will have this extra copy of the torus T everywhere. And actually there are n plus one extra copies of this torus T. And if you want to compute the tensor product multiplicity of the module mu-check, vee-mu-check inside the tensor product of modules with these labels, then it's nothing but the tropical fiber or tropical multiplicity over the point mu-check and all the lambdas. So at least we solve without computations the problem which we actually solved with Andrei Zelevinsky using some formulas, but as a product of two modules, but in fact it's uniform, and whatever positive structure you choose on that variety, which is very big, it has many copies of U, many copies of T, but still it's positive, and the positive structure is governed by whatever cluster structure on that variety. It's a cluster variety as well. And so we have infinitely many formulas for the tensor product multiplicity for free. But again, for free after maybe nearly 20 years of work. Well, I'm getting closer to the end. So now let me tell in brief what could be a possible mirror symmetry behind it. Since our category is monoidal in the presence of G, almost monoidal, then there is a notion of an algebra in such a category. So it's just any object which has associative multiplication. Well, associative layer just has multiplication. Then since our functor nu, again, psi or without psi, is monoidal, then nu of A is an algebra in the category of G for check modules. But if you look at such an algebra, then clearly it has a spectrum, which is some scheme with a G-check action. Well, what we hope is that the scheme is not just a scheme, but an algebraic variety, and spectrum of our functor apply to the algebra in the category of multiplicities. And what we expect based on many examples is that this is a mirror dual of our multiplicity variety in some sense. So maybe I'll say it in words rather than rating, which I didn't. If our variety was H, was T, itself. So the it was a an algebra in the category because T is a group, and it had a multiplication. Product of two copies of T is whatever T times U, which is a group. So we have a multiplication, and then the resulting algebra is just the coordinate algebra of G-check mod U-check. So in that sense, our variety is G-check mod U-check, which in some sense is Langlands, well, sorry, mirror dual to G mod U. So it's self-dual in a sense. We can replace it by many other examples. For instance, in the situation of when G is the Levy subgroup of some bigger group, G prime, we also have candidates for such a variety which compute such that the functor is just the sum of all those G modules which are corresponding to some to parabolic weights, and therefore the algebra nu of A is current algebra of G mod not the parabolic but the parabolic but the commutator subalgebra of the parabolic. So like G mod U is the same thing as G mod commutator of B and B. And then we expect that therefore the coordinate algebra of this variety shows up on the right hand side of our functor, and the variety G check mod commutator of P check is itself is the mirror dual in, again in this sense to the variety G mod commutator bracket of P and P for any parabolic subgroup P. Well, the indications which for such a mirror duality come from work of Cohen and Rich, who proved that the potential which we used with David Kashdan for well, again, so something which is left under the rug. So this essentially is the potential is exactly the one whose critical locus is the spectrum of the quantum cohomology of G-check mod P-check. So therefore, we expect that a lot of mirror symmetry is going on, but we are in the very first steps of just, we have very, very few examples on of our own, mostly from the literature, that indeed this variety X-check should be a mirror dual of the variety A understood properly. Variety A should be replaced by A times G mod U, of course, over the torus as the context suggests. But anyway, it's a lot of technicality. That's why I didn't put much of it into this slide. So the hope is that this variety X check shows up in the behind the mirror for many algebras now category of multiplicity varieties. Another cute aspect is that if you vary the group G with the same torus T, for instance GLN, SP2N, and SO2N plus one share the same torus, then we get several multiplications of the category of multiplicities, which could be of interest. We don't have many examples of categories with several products. Now we have at least five for each torus. That's basically it. So again, sorry for the typos and being too brief, but I hope the flavor of those symmetries and why multiplicities should be geometrized is clear. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. So any questions? Okay. May I ask a simple question? Is it necessarily true that A is finitely generated in this case?
Well, when I say algebra, I mean essentially monoid without unit. Unfortunately, the category is not linear, or fortunately, it's a category of varieties. So therefore, when I say monoid, I mean that if you look at this strange gadget, which is A times oh. A of stuff, it goes to A. Then it's an operation. It's not totally trivial. I mean, if you take, say, theta star star 2 over g to t, it requires a bit of work to show such an operation. So anyway, algebra means a monoid in this category, but this category is strange. It doesn't have a unit, so I don't know how to call it. Probably algebra is the lesser of the two evils. It's just a very strange associative operation in this category, which is not the same as multiplication in the group.
Any more
so
questions?
Again, maybe just a comment. So if you take again A times G mod U or something, it becomes an honest G variety with multiplicity A somehow. And that probably has a better flavor than we can see a bit more on this side of the mirror. So maybe I should have looked at A times G mod U rather than A itself.
Any more questions? So let's think, Arkady. And go. Reaction. Thank you very much for the great talk. And I'll stop here for today. Thank you all very much for coming. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll definitely send the correct slides shortly.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.